example. I, student manager Aditi Mathe, feel privileged to introduce our guest for the evening, Mr. Sangramsinh Pawar. Sir is a head corporate HR, OD, and HR CoE's at Syntel Private Limited. He is a seasoned HR professional with a very unique blend of strategic HR, talent management, organization management, consulting practice, and business excellence with more than 18 years of rich experience nationally and internationally. Sir is one of the leaders in the field of organization, change management, and has consulted in Fortune 100 companies. Sir has done his PGI RPM in industrial relations, labor laws, and personal management along with BSc and MSW. He is also a qualified professional in PhD, HRD, organizational behavior and development.
And I'm really overwhelmed with the reception what I've got today. I remember my 20 years back, these days when I was sitting on that side and I was listening to the guest speakers and I thought, when I'll grow to that level. But life goes on, right? You have to keep on learning and we have to keep on moving. So I'd like to start with, and many of us must have heard this, before I start, and I just wanted to check how we would like to go. Do we like to make it more of a question answer kind of session, more interactive? Huh? Right? Okay, so what I'll do is, I'll read a quote from King Martin Luther, and then we open the forum. Right? Is it okay? How much time do I have? 1 hour, right? After 1 hour, I'm not going to bore you. On Sundays, typically, right? It's so difficult. Okay. I'll just quickly read out this. It's very important and it's very relevant today also, right? What King Martin Luther's speech says, this is the most important and crucial period of your lives. Still, it is relevant to me today. For what you do now, what you decide now, at this age, may well determine which way your life shall go. And the question is, whether you have a proper, a solid, and a sound blueprint. And I want to suggest some of the things that should be in your life's blueprint. The first, a deep belief in your own dignity, your own worth, your own somebodyness. Don't allow anybody to make you feel that you are nobody. Very powerful statement. Always feel that you count. Always feel that you have worth and always feel that your life has ultimate significance. There is purpose of life for each one of us. You must have a basic principle, the determination to achieve excellence in your various fields of endeavor. You are going to be deciding as the days and the year unfold what you will do in life, what your life's work will be. Once you discover what it will be, set out to do it and to do it well. It's not ordinary, it's extraordinary. Be a bush if you can't be a tree. If you can't be a highway, just be a trail. If you can't be a sun, be a star. For isn't by size that you win or fail, be the best of whatever you are going to do. Whichever field you are, be the best. Aim for the best. Finally, in your life's blueprint must be a commitment to eternal principles of beauty, love, and justice. Well, life for none of us has been a crystal staircase, but we must keep moving. We must keep going. If you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. If you can't walk, crawl. But by all means, keep moving. keep moving, keep moving. Lot of power, right? Lot of power in the statements. King Martin Luther has made and taught us lot of things in life. And lot of good people have said the same thing. Whichever areas you are, be the best. Strive for excellence. And don't leave ordinary life. Leave the legacy behind. If you want to become great, if today you are good, that is not sufficient. You have to compete with yourself. And it's not competing with others. Right? You'll have to compete with yourself. You have to break your own records. What Usain Bolt has done, right? He doesn't compete with others. He competes with himself. It's not peer pressure. It's my pressure. Right? I have to introspect. I have to watch myself and to strive for better. That is going to make you successful in your career. And as rightly said by my student fellows, is success is not a destination, it's a journey. Very truly said. What brought me today here is not going to take me to the next level. Today's knowledge and today's competence is going to be irrelevant tomorrow. What it means is you have to keep on upskilling, you have to keep on reskilling yourself, you have to keep on resharpening your saw. What Stephen Covey also says, right? You have to keep on resharpening your saw and you have to be relevant to the industry, relevant to the times, relevant to the circumstances, relevant to the family, relevant to the peers, relevant to the friend circles, relevant to the society. If you are relevant, your value would be there in the society. If you are irrelevant, people will not acknowledge you. So whatever skills, whatever competence today you have, whatever aspirations you have come up with, your dreams which you have come into this field, you have to take it to the next level, and it's a continuous process, it's a journey of excellence. That particular principle will take you long way in your life, right? Academics is good. That will give you knowledge. But knowledge without experience is zero. You have to keep on experiencing, you have to keep on applying that knowledge and see how the skills are upgraded. You have to be continuously in touch with the industry, the ecosystem, and you have to be relevant in the industry. So most of the organizations now they are talking about relevance and relevant index. In our organization also we are talking about, one of my colleagues is also sitting here, Sumit Kakkar. So we always now talking about, and he's from training function. And it's so much of pressure is there on our heads. With today's economy not doing so great, going in doldrums, and next 3-4 years, 5 years, there's a lot of correction which is going to happen in the industry. Believe me, relevance is a word which is going to hit the market. That's why I'm actually, you know, speaking on the relevance more. And we are also talking about technology relevance index. We talk about upskilling, continuous reskilling, and invest on the skills, on your core skills and your renewable skills. So that's the industry which is going through today. The competition has become so fierce. It's volatile world, it's VUCA world what we're talking about. And this VUCA world, nobody knows where we are heading towards. Long-term goals are not relevant now. It's all short-term, mid-term goals what we're talking about. We don't know how the industries are going to change. When you'll pass out next year, a lot of change would be there in the industry. And that time you will be in the phase oh, what I learned in first year, second year, what I'm going to do now with that knowledge? Is it relevant? If it is not, and if you keep on upskilling yourself, then you will be relevant to the campus. If you don't upskill yourself, you'll be irrelevant, right? Campus and getting into the stream of corporate life is the first stage of your career. The more important is sustenance of the stage. How well you sustain in the industry. It's an ecosystem. It's a fierce competition. If you don't prove yourself every day, every hour, every second, every minute, someone else would prove and you are out of the system. Why the organization should pay you? What you're going to give back to the organization in terms of the ROI, return on investments? If not, they better not join the corporate life. That's how the corporate life has become. It's become very fierce, it's become very volatile, and in a volatile situation, it's I, who will have to work on the skills, on replenishing the skills, sharpening my skills, competence, and be relevant to the industry. With this, what I'll do is, you know, I'll open the forum and we can then start, you know, interacting with each other. And then I can share my past experiences, how I have grown to this position, but still I feel that I am as good as the audience sitting at that side. I'm still a trainee in my life. I feel that because there's so rapid change which is happening. And adapting to the change is the competence which each one of us will have to have to make us relevant in the industry. And today also I feel that I am trainee because I feel whatever I learned last 20 years has become obsolete. What next? What next? What next? What's going to happen after 10 years, 5 years? I don't know. And we all are struggling towards that. Believe me, friends, you know, if you don't, you are not awakened today, you are not going to be relevant tomorrow. So this is a time, these 2 years are going to be very crucial for you. Very, very crucial for you. Campus should not be your aim and objective. Your aim and objective is successful career, excellence in whatever you do, and leaving a legacy for the next generation. That should be the aim of your life. When I go back to my college, you know, the deans, the professors, then they meet me and they say, you know, after 20 years, how you feel? I say, I am still the same trainee in the campus, and that too, campus of corporate world, where everyone is there to teach me. Only important is my senses should be open. Nobody is going to hold your finger, your hand, and say, you know, kid, you need to do this, you need to do that in corporate world. It's keeping your senses open is very, very important. And self-learning is going to be the key for you all. Today you all feel, and this is the age, I have also gone through this age, that, you know, jo bhi hoga dekha jayega yaar, koi fark nahi padta hai. Right? Because we have that energy in us. And we have that dream. Good to have that. But we should be cognizant about the fierce competition outside. And that is where you will have to struggle a lot in terms of honing the skills and knowledge in the industry. Okay, so what I'll do is, I'll quickly open the floor and then we can have more interactions. And believe me, you know, I'm also similar to you. I might not have all the answers you have because wisdom is something, again, has become a continuous, on continuous basis. So whatever I learned, I'll try to share with you and give some good examples, not only from the corporate world, but analogy to sports, analogy to performing arts, because I have been into all these fields. So I can share a lot of things on those lines as well. What other fields like performing arts, what other fields like sports has given to me to become more successful in my corporate life?
Thanks, sir. To your right.
Oh.
Yeah. I am Rajal.
Hi, Rajal.
Sir, you shared a really valuable information.
Yeah.
And I would like to ask, you mentioned changes in the market. There will be changes coming in the market. So what are these changes? And according to you, what all skills, apart from the book mentioned skills, we should imbibe to achieve these achieve these changes?
Yeah. Good question. So as I said, you know, IT organizations, manufacturing organizations, the whole value chain in the industry is going through a bad phase. I should say it's not a bad phase, but learning phase, I should say. I am putting it very positively because bad times teaches you a lot than good times, right? Yes or no? Bad times teaches you a lot than the good times. So coming back to the industry has become very cost conscious. Revenues are going down day by day, quarter by quarter. YOY, the revenues are really going down. Sales are hitting. There's a lot of political instability, a lot of geographical instability. There's a whole new paradigm which is coming in different geos, is of protecting their own culture, protecting their own people. So because of that, the globalization is going getting affected in terms of sales, in terms of the overall growth in the industry. And in this situation, what has happened is organizations have become more and more cost conscious. What it means is organization wants to extract maximum out of their employees in lesser cost, because there is no margin left in the business. Margins are going down. Your sales is going down. The inflow of money is stagnant, right? So what has happened is, because of that, there's a lot of pressure back on people. And when there's a lot of pressure, we have to have different skills and competence required in the organization. One, as I rightly shared, continuous learning culture is happening in the organization, which is going to be focused for the organization in the next 3-4 years, and rigorous learning. So one has to be in a continuous mode of upskilling and reskilling oneself. Second part is adapting to change is very, very important. The change is happening so fast, and if you are not responding to the change positively, you'll be out of the game. So adapting to the change is very, very important. The third part is focus, bringing back the focus, evolving the core, what we always say. Looking back, introspecting, reflecting on what is the business all about, what are my strengths on which I should play, and how I should build the customer base. So again, it talks about playing on the strengths, focusing on the strengths, and building over it, right? Third part is, very, very important part is commitment. The commitment to the organization, commitment to yourself, and commitment to the delivery. Delivery is becoming very, very important in the organization. And delivery excellence is going to be more and more important, because customer will come to you if you are selling excellent products. You are selling excellent solutions to the customer. Today, customer has a lot of choices. Lot of vendors are there to provide solutions to the customers. But if you want to be the preferred vendor, then you will have to change yourself. You have to be relevant to what customer demands. And that is where the whole organization will have to get aligned. And that is where the skill sets are going to be very, very important. The skill sets, what we are looking at, will have to be aligned to the changing system, the changing demand of the customer. So in cheaper rate, selling products is going to be another paradigm which is going to happen, because there are a lot of vendors, small players, startups coming up, and there are a lot of organizations who have grown last 20 years. A lot of liabilities are there for the organizations. They are competing in the same market. So what it means is, you have to sell your product at low cost, with good quality, and faster reach to customer. So the response time is going down. What it means is, you have to be faster responding to customer requirements. We are thinking in IT industry is going to grow so fast and rapidly that today we take efforts to create the software. But with machine learning, artificial intelligence coming in, with robotics coming in, you will get the products in an hour's time. All APIs built, you're going to get the products in an hour's time. So most of the job, the machine learning is going to take over. What it means is, a lot of redundancies are going to happen in the market. So if you are not relevant to machine learning, artificial intelligence in terms of building those kind of skills, you will be out of the market. Automation is the key. Robotics is going to be the key. So all those competence, all the skills required towards that will be required to be built by the individuals. Thank you.
Good evening, sir.
Have I answered you? Rajan?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir. My name is Sameeksha. First of all, first of all, whatever you said is quite actual and relevant. Sir, I wanted to ask, you just said a term like upskilling and reskilling yourself. Sir, can you explain this with some practical examples, and what does it mean actually?
Yeah, so just an example I'll give you. Most of the organizations are building career path architectures in the organization. What it means is, we're trying to really work on the core skills. Like, for a very simple example is Java is one of the core skills what we're talking about, back end, front end, both. So all those skills which are core skills, and all those skills which are niche skills, like niche skills which are in the field of big data, right? Because BI is going to be very important in future. So all the skills which are relevant to that are going to be niche skills. So when you talk about reskilling and upskilling, there are two things. One is the projects which are coming to us, right? Whether our current people are relevant to those projects, right? And then whether we are really helping them to build those skills. So training plan based on the gaps, what we identify. So we have just, in Syntel, we have come up with Syntel X.0 program, which talks about skilling and reskilling part, and it's more of a resource management as well as talent management piece, right? So what we are saying is, we have identified 197 skills in the organization, which are relevant to the business, which are relevant to our kind of strengths in the services industry. And what we have done is, we have come up with the proficiency levels for each skill. So whether it's skill or knowledge, we have come up with S1, proficiency level 1, 2, proficiency level 5 or 3, depending on the topic, the knowledge, the skill. And what we have done is, we have blended with the skill and knowledge part together And we have created a model where we are going to assess our people against that. And once the assessments are done, we will say there will be a learning plan attached to it, so that people can go, relook into the skill, learn, and make themselves relevant to the industry. Okay. Thank you.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, on your left.
Sorry. Yeah.
Sir, my name is Madhur.
Yeah.
Sir, my question is, how do you avoid being complacent at your job, and what is the biggest advice you give to a management trainee who is starting his career in your company?
Okay. So are we all complacent some other time? Hai na? Thodi susti chad jati hai na sabko. That's how we are. That's how people are. That's how human beings are, right? The only way to come out of the complacency is challenging yourself. I told about Usain Bolt's example. He fights for his own score, for his own records, not somebody else. Right? A simple example I'll give you of mine. I was heading HR for Persistent in Pune. My family stays in Pune, right? But I said, no, complacency is setting in me. I have to move out. I said, let me move out and go to different geos. So today I am working in Mumbai, though my family stays here. So I am challenging myself. So you have to keep on challenging yourself that, okay, what I am doing today, is it really relevant to the market, to the industry? If not, then I have to come out of that. Right? Don't spend more time on comfort levels. You should be uncomfortable all the times. That will keep you moving. That will keep you learning. Right? The time you feel that I have learned everything, mujhe kuch sikhna nahi hai abhi, that is a time for your fall. That is a stage where you start falling down. So never feel that you have learned everything. Aapko pura dunya ka gyan aa gaya hai. Right? Never feel that. I'll give an example of Sachin Tendulkar. Would you like to hear that?
Yes.
He's a hero, right? For us. So I'd like to give an example of his. I played for 13 years together. So I played 6 years with him. I was opening Vezone. And I have good memories playing with him. I used to open along with him for the Vezone. So what I learned from him is, he used to be never in the complacency mode. He used to continuously introspect his own skills and his competence and why he is not able to perform. Questioning yourself, why I'm not able to perform, is very, very important. Even if the world sees you as a performer, but still you know where you are not performed. You have known to your weaknesses. Work on it. I'll give an example. And Motera Stadium in Ahmedabad, when we were playing together, he made 107 and became out. I was in Baroda's team, and I was the total score of Bombay was 634, where Kamli also made 100, Sachin also made 100, and Abhijit Kale made 248, and total score went above 630, and so it was 3 days match, and I was fielding him at the silly point, and this guy was going great guns. He was hitting everywhere. In half an hour, he scored 107 runs. In half an hour, he scored 107 runs, and he was caught at the deep mid wicket, and he went back to the pavilion, where Bishan Singh Bedi was there as a observer. Karsan Ghauri was one of the selectors. And when he went back, nobody saw him outside the pavilion, He went back and they were searching, where's Sachin gone? Sachin was in front of the mirror trying to understand what made him out. What made him out? That is why he's great today. Nobody told him that you go in the mirror, in front of the mirror, and look at why is becoming out, why went you know actually his wicket fell. That was a great learning for all of us, that you know you have to actually introspect, you have to retrospect, and nobody is going to come and tell you that, hey guy, you know, आपके लिए पूरा सब खुला है मार्केट, आप आओ परफॉर्म करो, मत करो, नहीं करो भी तो भी चलेगा. इट्स नॉट दैट. यू हैव टू कीप ऑन इंट्रोस्पेक्टिंग, यू हैव टू कीप ऑन रिट्रोस्पेक्टिंग योर सेल्फ एंड परफॉर्म. देर इज नो आंसर टू परफॉर्मेंस. बिलीव मी गाइज, प्लेइंग 18 ईयर्स 20 ईयर्स विद द सेम रिगर, विद द मेटाबॉलिक फंक्शंस ऑफ योर बॉडी गोइंग डाउन विद द एज, is not easy. And giving the same results to the country is not easy.
Good evening, sir. My name is Rishikesh Kudal. Sir, on your right. On your right, sir.
Yeah. Yeah,
sir. Sir, yesterday we had a wonderful session with Mr. RVM from RVM Foundation. And okay. Sir, he asked a very simple question to define success for our own self. So, sir, none of us could really answer that question. So, I would like to ask.
Should I answer back? Should yes, I answer? Ask you back the same question?
Sir, I could not answer okay. The same, that's why okay. I'm asking
okay.
you.
Okay. So success, you want to know what is success, right?
For you, sir, yeah.
Success for me is a continuous journey, what she said aptly, that you know, it's a continuous journey. Success is achieving your milestones on your continuum of life. It's achieving milestones on the continuum of life. I'm not saying one time. It's a continuum of life. So all the milestones which are there in front of you, you have to keep on achieving that with the same rigor, with the same excellence in life. That is what success for me is.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
On your left.
Yeah.
Hello.
Sir.
In academic mic is there, I got a little bit, yeah.
Sir, I have two questions for
okay.
you. Sir, according to you, the HR in the IT industry or HR in any other industry, what different skills that person should have to work in the IT industry or
okay.
to work in any other industry?
Are you interested in this topic?
Yes, no,
HR wale? Haath wapas upar uthaiye. So IT and non-IT, what
yes,
you're talking about,
yes,
right?
Sir.
Folks, believe me, in for HR specialization or HR professionals, you will have to keep your mind open. HR is HR wherever you go. It's people, right? Manufacturing organizations also is made up of people. IT organizations are also made up of people, right? So the most important skill and competence is how you manage the talent in the organization. How you manage the talent of the organization effectively. That is going to be the core. Second part is IT and manufacturing. There is a little bit, you know, difference there. In manufacturing organization, you will have to be very strong on legal systems, law, on industrial relations. Because in manufacturing organizations, we have blue collar workers as well as white collar workers, right?
Yes, sir.
And blue collar workers, they typically they are unionized. Right? Law protects them. So you as an individual, when you stand on the floor and there are some issues, you will have to confront it with legal knowledge at the back of your mind. You cannot go arbitrarily. Right? So that is one very, very different skill set which is required for people who are going to get into manufacturing organizations. You will have to be cognizant about the fact the people are coming from rural background to the industry. Their cultural their cultures, their belief structures, their behaviors. You need to study a lot on that because you are going to deal with workers there, blue collar workers, right? And also you are going to deal with staff, which is your white collar workers. So that's an additional skill you'll have to hone. In terms of, you'll have to be very legally strong, you'll have to be open, you'll have to be very good at change management. As well as when it comes to IT, a lot of large IT organizations are changing very fast. So it's going to be very, very critical for HR folks to be business relevant, which means you will have to be true business partners. So understanding of business is going to be critical for HR folks. So you'll have to understand what is growth, what is revenue, what we're talking about margins, what we're talking about utilization, optimization, right? Where my business is getting hit, how I can really mobilize my talent, how can I provide insights to my business leaders so that I can become a business partner for them. So knowing business is going to be very critical for HR folks who are going to be in IT, which is notch above others in terms of, because the speed of change is very high in IT. Manufacturing organizations, it has a linear growth and the slow, steady pace of through which it grows and changes. But here, since it's a service industry, since it is a product industry as well, we'll have to respond to the customers quickly. And that's where agility is going to play a very vital role for all the HR people. The response time to the customer is going to reduce, right? And you'll have to be very excellent in your own skills. So you have to rework and sharpen your own HR skills, and you have to be relevant to the business for IT setup.
Thank you for valuable information.
Yeah.
My name is Ankita. Sir, my question to you is, can you please tell how sports life help you to be successful in corporate life?
Yeah. Okay. So how many of you have played sports? Sub. Good. Very nice to know. Sports has taught me a lot. Sports has given me a discipline of life. Because when you are playing sports, are you hearing me? Okay. When you are playing sports, you are in a fierce competition. Everyone wants to play nationals. Everyone wants to play Indian team. Everyone wants to play states, right? And due to competition, you learn how to reskill yourself continuously. You have to be competent in the game, right? Second part is, sports has taught me a team approach, collaboration. When you are individual in the organization and in the function, you are not only individual there. There are colleagues who are working with you in business, in your function, your teams. So collaboration is the second part which I learned from the sports field, because cricket is all about collaboration. It's not individual, though you have to perform individually, but teamwork is very, very important, right? So that is another thing what I learned. The third part is the focus. I talked about Sachin Tendulkar. One more example I'll give you there. So Sachin used to, at the age of 11 and 12, Sachin used to go back at his dressing rooms where we used to stay in lodging boards. And we used to, like what he used to do is, at the age of 11, for the next day, he used to put up a plan on a paper. Now we call it as a strategy in corporate world, quote unquote, but at the age of 11, he used to work out for the next day. That was what commitment was there, the focus in the game. He was not worried about the external part, what is happening. He was very much worried about how I am going to perform tomorrow, how my strategy should be there for tomorrow's game. So that has taught me a lot. If I want to deliver to my organization, I have to do a lot of homework for tomorrow, right? I have to be very committed to myself before I show my commitments to the organization, right? I have to be disciplined. I have to think of tomorrow and start working today, right? This is the learnings.
Good evening, sir. Sahiya, in front of you.
Yeah, Sahiya. Sorry.
Sir Devishriya, sir, I have one question that you told about the think about your successful career, but don't think about the placements. Then my question is that, sir, if we don't think about our placements, then this is our first stage for the successful career of our life. So how should be our plan for the successful life? Thank you, sir.
Okay, coming to your question, is it right? How many people you are looking for campus immediately? Next year? Sabke haath upar aayenge? Aane chahiye, kyun nahi aane chahiye? Sabko nokri to chahiye na? Okay, so when I am saying this, everyone wants to be absorbed in the company, right? But I am asking you a question back, why corporate should take you? Why someone should pay you? Why someone should absorb you? Anyone can give the answer? आप ऐसे ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को क्या देने वाले हो तो ऑर्गेनाइजेशन आपको ले? Why corporate should take you and pay you 9 lakhs, 14 lakhs, 10 lakhs, 8 lakhs? In return, how we are going to help the organization to grow? And why someone should absorb you? It's a hard fact, I'm asking you.
Because we have capability.
Capability.
We are here to become capable. And capability. At next stage, we will be capable.
Person. Correct. That's what Balaji is aiming for, right? As an institute? Yes? Good answer. So what it means is, you are not looking for campus. You are looking for long-term capability, right? Knowledge. How we are going to bring value to the organization. Return on investments, right? If I am going to invest in you 8 lakhs, 9 lakhs, 10 lakhs, 14 lakhs, in return, in 1 year, 2 year span, how we are going to get the returns for my business, right? I am going to spend on you. So if you don't have capabilities, if you don't have skills, if you don't have knowledge, if you don't have wisdom, if you don't have intelligence, right? Why my business has to hire you? So first and foremost important part is, though campus is very, very important because that is going to be the first milestone which you're going to achieve, but more important is why I should be hired. If you answer that question, campus will be easy. People will hire you. Did I answer you? Answer is me, na?
Hello sir, up in the balcony. Sir, here.
Yeah.
Up in the balcony. Sir, my name is Vivid Jain, and sir, my question to you is, sir, is downfall in IT due to the boom in technology such as bots and cloud computing?
Didn't get your question right.
Is downfall in IT due to the boom in technology such as bots and cloud computing?
Okay. So it's not because of that. There are a lot of other areas also, as I rightly shared with you. A lot of automation is going up, and what you're talking about is chatbots and those other areas in testing, in development and maintenance as well. But when automation is going up, naturally your efforts are going to go down, right? Your efforts are going to go down. Therefore, the skills which would be required would be totally different in that case. But when it comes to the industry going down, is not because of that. It's because of a lot of other areas like political instability, right? US talking about their own skills, right? They want to provide jobs to their own people, right? They are not looking for H1s coming in, right? They have put in cap there, ceilings there. So a lot of other issues are also happening due to which the industry is holding back and waiting how the things are going to move in future. Second part is, IT is a service provider to the customers, to the core customers. If my banking sector is not doing well, if my automobile sector is not doing well, if my healthcare sector is not doing well, right? How my IT sector is going to do, right? Because my revenue is not going to come, my growth is not going to happen. That's why there's a dip in overall ecosystem. My end customer are very careful, very watchful to spend money. Today, if you go to market, you look at different phones, right? Whether it's Samsung, whether it's iPhone, a lot of phones in front of you. But you're very watchful to spend amount, what you have, right? When you have plenty of amount and when you have plenty of money with you, it's fine. But when it comes to meager amount, whatever funds you have, you have to spend those funds very cautiously, right? You will think twice, you will think 100 times, right, before taking a decision. Large customers are actually rethinking on bringing in automation. That is one part. Second thing is, because they want to respond to their customers very quickly. They want to add value to their customers very quickly, right? In the whole supply chain, value chain, it has become very cautious drive for all the businesses today. That's why it's slow, but it will pick up.
Good evening, sir. It's nice to see you here, sir.
Yes.
Sir, as we all are about to go in a corporate field, we will face a lot of problem, we will face a lot of challenges there. So my question is to you, sir, what is the biggest challenges you have faced in your corporate field? And how did you came out from that challenges?
The biggest challenge, for everyone here, I would say managing the change, right? What it means is the things are changing very fast. And if I am not ready for the change, right, I face challenges in the organization, right? So that was one of the major area where I have worked on my own, that I have to be adaptable to the change. If I am quiet to the change, I have resistance to the change, then actually I'm out of the system, right? People, so it's becoming relevant to the system, right? Again, going back to the relevance index. So that was a major challenge throughout my, this in that, the things have changed so lot. Last 20 years, everything has moved to automation, everything, the paradigms have changed, the business demands have changed, people demands have changed. And being in HR, I have to be relevant to people demands. I have to prove myself every time. So if you are not proving yourself every time, you're out of the system. So you have to deliver, you have to perform, and you have to neutralize the politics around. The major part in this kind of situation where there's a lot of threat, right? When we do SWOT analysis of the situation, there's a lot of threats which are there in the business today, which are people threats, which are team threats, which are business threats, right? Customer problems. In this kind of situations, it becomes very vital for me as an individual to think what is required and deliver that in lesser time, right? That's very important. So most of the organizations are moving towards Scrum and agile working methods, right? Have you heard about Scrum or agile frameworks? Yeah? So most of the organizations are working towards that, and they're moving away from waterfall approach. Long-term planning wala approach nikal gaya hai abhi. It's all quick 30, 60, 90 days plan and deliver. That's it. If you're not able to deliver, you're out.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, my name is Ashwara Shivastav. Sir, my question to you is, as you are a cricketer, sir, I'm also a national level cricketer. Sir, as I am having so many certificates. Are they of any relevance at the time of placement?
The certificates, again, I'll tell you, we will always look at team plays in the organization. Why not? Right? And games teaches you a lot of things. Games, performing arts, whether it's performing arts. Performing arts teach you a lot of creativity, right? Innovation, lateral thinking, right? Sports teaches you a lot of discipline, commitment to the organization, because you're committed to yourself, and that should help when organizations, they look forward for good team players in the organization.
Sir?
Good evening, sir. Sir here.
Yeah.
Sir, if a person from marketing background, after having 2 to 3 years of experience, want to switch to HR, will company recruit the marketing person for HR?
You know, job rotation has become very, very key for the organizations today, right? So I'll give an example of one of the examples. One of my senior colleagues who was heading HR for Satyam and then Tech Mahindra, he was very close to Raju, and that time Satyam was in boom, and his name was Hariti. I don't know whether you all heard his name, but he was heading HR, global HR for Satyam. And Satyam was an organization where people used to look forward in those days to join, right, from IT industry. He moved to marketing and mass communications. So when HR person can go to marketing and mass communications, why not vice versa also? Yeah? So one thing is very important. There are some competencies required for HR. Every function has its own competencies, the knowledge framework which is required. If you can bring that, you can quickly learn that and bring that to the table and hone that, why not? Most of the delivery people are getting into HR. A lot of engineers are getting into HR field. It's happening.